We pick up the story in 1958. Olof Palme is the head of Sweden's working group on nuclear weapons, and Sweden has the plutonium and bomb components to become the world's fourth largest nuclear armed nation, even while it positions itself as the global leader in nuclear disarmament. Palme, too, is something of a paradox. He claims to be the world's most strident opponent of nuclear weapons, even if he was actually in charge of creating them. Sweden set up two parallel nuclear weapons programs. The first was called the L program, or loading program, which was focused on deploying nuclear weapons to frontline military units. The second was the S program, or protection program, which was for civil defense. By 1959, Sweden had reached a crossroads. The bomb was ready to deploy, and it was important that Parliament be asked to vote on the matter. The leader of the opposition to the Swedish bomb was Inga Thorsson, the head of the Social Democratic Party's Women's Union. Her arguments split the parliament, which ultimately cancelled the bomb program. Still, as the Soviet threat loomed large, they voted to fund the S program. With the parliament's final vote on the matter, Sweden's nuclear bomb program had come to an end. Except it didn't. Instead, the Prime Minister, Tage Erlander, covertly rolled the bomb into what was supposed to have been the Defensive S program. Then, he appointed Olof Palme as its new head. By 1960, he increased the FOA's bomb effort to 200 staff. 5 years later, it reached almost 300. To explain this to Parliament, Erlander stated that nuclear offense and defense were essentially the same, at least from a scientific viewpoint. He said that if Sweden kept a wait-and-see policy that maintained what he called freedom of action, and if some portions of the bomb program were preserved, the parliament would retain the option of voting again if the Soviet threat worsened. It was all just doublespeak, though, and while Inga Thorsson and the Women's Union were placated, Erlanda and Palme got the nuclear bomb. Except it wasn't going to be just one, but rather hundreds. In 1960, a second breeder reactor came online at Studsvik, south of Stockholm. Then in 1964, a third at Ogesta. With that, Sweden was producing enough plutonium to manufacture 60 bombs per year, year after year thereafter. Also in 1960, the Saab Draken entered frontline service with the Swedish Air Force. It couldn't carry a nuclear bomb, however, and that meant that Sweden had the bomb, but still, no bomber. Its next aircraft, however, the Saab 37 Viggen, was purpose-built for the bomb, but it still required another 10 years of testing before it would be ready to enter frontline service. Complicating matters, at that point, America realized what was actually going on in Sweden. As a result, President Eisenhower offered if the Swedes disarmed, the United States would come to Sweden's aid if the Soviet Union ever attacked. That agreement was secretly codified into what was called the 37 Annex. However, Sweden secretly just continued its bomb programs anyway. Then, in 1963, the United States, Soviet Union, and United Kingdom signed the Limited Test Ban Treaty. That ended all atmospheric and underwater nuclear bomb tests. For Sweden, that meant they had no new bomb test data to support their own programs. In 1964, China tested its first nuclear bomb. The Swedes realized, however, that those tests weren't of use because they had just duplicated Russian copies of America's first bombs. Still without a suitable nuclear bomber, Sweden secretly started work on tactical missiles. It established a rocket range just east of the city of Kiruna in 1966 and a working group on space. For peaceful scientific purposes, of course. Finally, then, in 1967, the Saab 37 Viggen flew its first test flight. It seemed that Sweden would soon have both the bomb and the bomber for the first time in its history. The Viggen was scheduled to enter service with the Swedish Air Force in 1971, and the clock was ticking. As a result, America renewed its demands that Sweden disarm. Once again, Sweden just ignored the Americans. What it couldn't ignore, however, were the lessons of America's Vietnam War. There, American F-100 and F-105 attack jets were flying strike missions against the North Vietnamese, and like the new Viggen, These planes were capable of carrying nuclear weapons under the fuselage. America's huge B-52 bombers were also pummeling Hanoi. To win the war quickly, all America needed to do was drop a single bomb on Hanoi. So why didn't it? The answer seemed clear. If they did, they would kick off a global nuclear Armageddon and World War III. The fact was, America was sitting on hundreds, if not thousands, of nuclear weapons, but couldn't use them, even in war. This gave Swedish policymakers pause. If the Soviets invaded, would Sweden be able to use its nuclear weapons at all? With the tensions of the Cold War being what they were, the world was one bomb away from global Armageddon. That June in 1967, the Six-Day War kicked off in the Middle East. Within hours, the Israeli Air Force destroyed the combined air forces of all of the surrounding Arab nations. Israel showed just what an advanced, well-trained air force could do, even one that was vastly outnumbered. This was very inspiring for Sweden, and as a result, over 300 vegan jet fighters were put on order. The Swedish Air Force was about to expand dramatically. There was another lesson to be learned from the Six-Day War, however, and that was that the world quickly stepped in and stopped the Israeli advances. After careful analysis, the Swedes realized that if the Soviets ever did invade, the same would happen in the Baltic. This realization gave rise to the Margin Doctrine, which predicated that the Soviet Union could not attack Sweden in isolation, or if it did, that the rest of the world would quickly step in and stop the war. Thus, Sweden didn't have to go it alone anymore. Nuclear weapons were no longer the absolute guarantee of security that they needed. Still, they could imagine scenarios where Moscow might be able to attack Sweden. The best option seemed to be to shift from nuclear deterrence to political deterrence. Sweden would prepare to fight a conventional war and rely on the United States for nuclear retaliation. This set the stage for Sweden to finally disarm, and a message was sent to Washington. Sweden was ready to talk. In 1968, the deal was apparently done, though even today, its details remain secret. America's nuclear umbrella was put in place, and Sweden signed the Non-Proliferation Treaty. Then, in October 1969, after 23 years in office, Prime Minister Tage Erlander finally stepped down, handing over the reins to Olof Palme himself. The father of the Swedish bomb would be the very man called on to demonstrate compliance with the newly signed treaty. Therefore, in 1970, Sweden shut down its R1 nuclear reactor at Koteho in Stockholm. Quietly, Palme kept the more advanced reactor at Studsvik in operation, however. As well, he continued the construction of the other reactor at Ogesta. Meanwhile, the Saab Vegan finally joined frontline service in the summer of 1971. Whereas for years Sweden had had the bomb, but not the bomber, ironically, suddenly it had the bomber, but no longer had the bomb. Sweden's plutonium stocks were sold to the UK in 1972. And with that, Sweden's bomb program had finally reached the end, at least on paper. However, just prior to shipping the plutonium to the UK, Palme ordered the FOI to secretly conduct 10 nuclear blast tests. Those tests took place in underground rock caverns deep beneath Sulna, a neighborhood in northwestern Stockholm. They were so small that on the surface, all people heard was a distant rumble. The tests raise a question. Why would Sweden test a bomb when it was ending its bomb program? Reading between the lines, there's two obvious answers. First, Sweden would need to test a bomb if it was continuing its bomb programs, despite that that would be a direct violation of the Non-Proliferation Treaty. And second, since Sweden had already all of America's bomb test data, the only reason it needed to conduct a bomb test was because there was a scientific reason to do so. In other words, Sweden had developed something new. It seemed that Sweden had found a way to achieve critical mass with less than 5 kilograms of plutonium. In the years that followed, Sweden went to work on designing a new generation of tactical nuclear weapons, and globally, no one was the wiser. Most likely, the reason Sweden kept some nuclear capabilities was because it seemed unlikely that America would actually risk World War III just to save Sweden. To secretly keep a bomb was a good insurance policy. If attacked, Stockholm could threaten nuclear war. This would bring America to fulfill its commitments and would make the Soviets reconsider any invasion where the ultimate outcome would likely be global Armageddon. The logic was sound. Likewise, the reactors at Studsvik and Ogesta could be kept running. This enabled a quick return to plutonium production if ever needed. And, of course, this meant that Palme would have to lie about Sweden's nuclear program, though that wasn't exactly a new thing. By 1974, Sweden realized it could produce more plutonium than it needed, so the Bredy reactor at Ogesta was decommissioned. Only Studsvik was kept operational. Sweden would need 2 years to start large-scale plutonium production if the Soviet threat ever warranted it. Also in 1974, Sweden's rocketry program at Kiruna conducted its first missile launches, putting small payloads right up to the edge of space. A decision was made to continue for research purposes only, however. Sweden had the bomb and the bomber. It didn't need a missile, too. Between 1974 and 1985, Sweden brought another 11 nuclear reactors into operation, but these were for civilian purposes. Many of the former bomb scientists at FOA were moved into nuclear energy to keep them close at hand if ever there was a need to recall them. During this time, the FOI's remaining bomb staff researched and built a new advanced nuclear pulse generator to use as a bomb trigger. They also developed a new warhead design that they called a prototype implosion device. Both designs remain closely held secrets even to this day. The FOI's staffing charts show that while the number of scientists involved in the bomb was reduced, the program continued long after 1968, when Sweden had signed the Non-Proliferation Treaty. In the mid-1970s, there were still around 100 scientists working on the bomb. By 1980, that number was still 75. In fact, for 4 decades after Sweden signed the Non-Proliferation Treaty, it was still just 1 vote away in Parliament from becoming a nuclear weapons state. It had the weapons designs, the scientific expertise, and the manufacturing capacity in place. It had at least 1 and maybe 2 bombs in storage, though for technical compliance with the Non-Proliferation Treaty, the components were kept disassembled and in secret storage. In 1980, Ronald Reagan was elected President of the United States. The tension of the Cold War ramped up dramatically. In October 1981, a Soviet Whiskey-class submarine ran aground on the rocks near the Swedish Navy base at Karlskrona. Covert Geiger counter readings revealed that the sub was carrying a nuclear weapon on board. This presented a new problem for Sweden. Whiskey-class submarines were among the Soviet Union's oldest, and the boat was on a routine patrol when it ran aground. It was just one of many that were regularly trespassing into Swedish waters at the time. Suddenly it became clear. The Soviets were more threatening than Sweden had ever realized. Most importantly, it seemed that the Soviet submarines were also deploying nuclear weapons with small tracked vehicles that they crawled along the seabed deep into Stockholm's waters. This meant it was possible for the Soviets to pre-position timer-detonated nuclear bombs on the seabed just offshore. Likewise, Soviet bombers were making regular runs at the Swedish border, each time turning away when they were intercepted by Sweden's Air Force. Nonetheless, Sweden stayed quiet about its bomb. In 1985, Prime Minister Olof Palme even traveled to Delhi in India to speak at a disarmament conference. He called the bomb human madness and redefined the nuclear arms argument along neo-colonial lines. However, 13 months after Delhi, on February 28, 1986, Olof Palme was killed. To this day, his death remains unsolved. Recently, the government closed the case, calling it an act of random violence committed by a man named Stig Engström. Rather conveniently, Engström later committed suicide. Palme's death, however, didn't end the bomb program. In fact, in 1990, the FOR was still employing around 40 scientists in the nuclear weapons program. A year later, in 1991, the threat of invasion ended when the Soviet Union fell, and finally, Sweden began a long disarmament. Sweden's Air Force, by then the fourth largest in the world, was pared back sharply, and the vegans were retired. Sweden welcomed a new generation of fighter jets with the new Saab Gripen. Like its predecessors, it kept Sweden on a par with the best the Americans and the Russians have. A decade later, in 2005, Sweden shut down its breeder reactor at Studsvik. The country had finally ended plutonium production almost 40 years after it had signed the Non-Proliferation Treaty. Then, in 2012, Sweden surprised the world when Prime Minister Fredrik Reinfeldt directed Carl Bildt to announce the transfer of 3.3 kilograms of plutonium to the United States. That was the ultimate proof. Sweden had kept just enough plutonium to build at least one bomb after all. And perhaps that's it. Perhaps. Although a newly resurgent Russia under Vladimir Putin could force Sweden to restart its nuclear weapons programs. And why wouldn't it? Maybe that's a question best left for another day. I'm Thomas Van Hare, and this is Historic Wings. Please subscribe, and remember, there's always more to the story.